Somewhere between London and Durham, I lost my voice. Can you actually hear me? Okay. Which I think is quite fitting for thinking about how feminist theory moves. Though I'm not quite sure in exactly what ways. I'm also somewhere between seasons, which is again slightly fitting because I left snow and I arrived at 80 degrees. And somehow I thought it would be 80 degrees in here, which is why I'm wearing flip-flops. But a friend of mine once said that part of being a feminist theorist is acknowledging that you'll always be inappropriately dressed for every occasion. So I'm just living up to this. I don't know what that means, really. It's my absolute great pleasure to be here. It really does feel like my second intellectual home, and I want to add my thanks that Tina gave to Robin for organising the conference, and also for really making women's studies at Duke such an incredibly vibrant, fantastic place to reside within. So that although on the one hand, Robin, you're always saying that you don't know what feminist theory means, on the other hand, you do that in ways that have the most incredible energy and bring together affect with intellectual rigor in ways that are incredibly unusual. So that even if I don't always know what feminist theory means when I've heard you speak, I know how I feel about it. And that, to me, is something that is lacking, actually, from a lot of theory today and is lacking from a lot of different contexts that feeling and intellectual production are brought together. So my current research, as Tina so generously in her introduction mentioned, is on the significance of telling feminist stories in the West, for how gender as a concept is mobilized more broadly in transnational social, political, and cultural contexts. And my interest is in bringing together historiography and global mobilization of gender norms to look at how they come together. And they're often sort of held apart in lots of ways. So very often people talk about the co-optation of feminism by global agendas and don't look so closely at the ways in which the way we tell the history of feminist theory actually in many ways coincides with that. So I'm interested in a sense in making myself and feminist theory more generally accountable for the global mobilization of gender. I mean, it's a very large project, isn't it? As well as tracking the overlaps between the histories we tell of feminist thought and their supposed co-optation by the mainstream, I'm also interested in developing theoretical experiments that help increase feminists' accountability for their historical accounts and provide, I hope, a mode of imagination that is always utopian in intent, but without settled object or goal. You could see then the work in a slightly different way, which is to ask, what is the point of theory at this point in time or in this historical juncture? How is the story of Western feminist theory told? What do we think has happened in the last four decades of institutional production of theory under that rubric? Despite the complexity of individual position, disciplines, objects, and techniques that make up a Western feminist theoretical field, there are common threads that constitute a vision of feminist theoretical history that fascinate me. These threads should feel familiar, and indeed you may tend towards, I expect you will, one or the other. It would be odd if you didn't. The first one that I'm sketching here, progress, runs something like this. We used to think of woman or feminism as a unified category, but through the subsequent efforts of black, lesbian, and postmodern feminist theory, we have diversified the field and have moved into an era of celebration of difference. In the process, we have developed a variety of epistemological and methodological tools, and critiqued the scope, reach, and ontological narrowness typical of Western feminism's earlier preoccupations and subjects. At its purest, we may no longer need a focus on women or gender per se. Those days are gone now. The characteristics of this narrative: fragmentation, celebration, institutionalization. Loss. We used to think of feminism as unified, but progressive, or woman, but progressive fragmentation, loss of purpose, including loss of socialist feminist commitments, and shifts to the right have resulted in an increasing depoliticization and uncertainty of purpose. Yes, yes, we know things weren't perfect, but at least we made an effort to focus on the political. Unlike academics and youth in general today, who are lamentably ahistorical. At its purest, feminism has failed, and the abstract and mainstream nature of theory today stands as its sign. The characteristics: fragmentation, nostalgia, and social movements. And I have to point out that the top line of every page of my paper has been cut off, so I'm going to make that line up. So we really don't know what feminists... Both stories divide the recent past into clear decades to provide a narrative of relentless progress or loss, proliferation or homogenization. You will know without me telling you that the past is the 1970s, occasionally the 1960s. The shifts are identitarian, public or institutional, and denote the 80s, and that the 1990s is the decade of difference proper. You might also be thinking that there is a school of thought way of thinking about the shifts too, radical or socialist to black feminist theory and sexual politics to postmodernism, or liberal through sex politics to postmodernism, or sexual difference to postcolonialism, and of course, beyond. Third, returns, because obviously we're not in the 1990s anymore. We have lost our way, but we can get it back. We thought the turn to language would allow us to deconstruct power and to value difference. But it turned out, in fact, to be a conservative dead-end job. We don't have to accept fragmentation or unity. We can learn the lessons of post-colonialism and value what sexual difference theory taught us we had in common without nostalgia. A bit of common sense wouldn't go awry after all this abstraction, after all. Come on now, be reasonable. We can value collective knowledge without fear of universalization, can't we? What about embodiment and affect as sources of knowledge? What about enduring inequalities that still have to be addressed? What about the material context of our lives, she says seriously. Can't we stop this silliness now and take some intellectual and ethical risks? Characteristics: neomaterialism, post-poststructuralism, reunification, pragmatism, disciplinarity. You may be able to tell from my tone that I remain skeptical of the returns as of the progress and loss narratives, for reasons that I hope will become clear in due course. However inflected, the chronology remains the same, the decades overburdened yet curiously flattened. Politics have been surpassed and need to be returned to. And progressive institutionalization, high theory, and the narcissism of other peoples, of course, youth, constitute evidence for this combined story of feminism's demise or transformation. In the process, a point I'll come back to, key subjects of feminist theory are disappeared, as post-structuralism is animated as the key actor in challenging woman as the ground for feminist politics and knowledge production, whether you embrace or think that this is about loss. While in the return narratives, it is construed often as an interruption to serious feminist social concerns with embodiment or the social world. It is black, and I'll come back to this, it is black and lesbian feminist subjects who are the most difficult to place in the present within these histories, a point I'll come back to, but which makes me very anxious about what these histories do. I've got a little subheading here, why does any of this matter? Many of you will, I think, be very familiar with some of the broader resonances of this historical production of theory in the present. For social and cultural theorists, this telling of stories contributes to the construction of feminism in general as over, critically and politically. And for those who continue to believe in its relevance, as not cutting edge at best, or worse, as locked into a previous era of identity politics or essentialism. In any case, who wants to be anachronistic? To be a feminist theorist is to be placed in time as well as in space, and that time is emphatically not now. This chimes with media and broader cultural renditions of feminism as over, as having had its day, and of course, as having done its job in the West, always preserving a role for it elsewhere, where presumably it will also no longer be necessary eventually. Gloria Wecker, in 2004, notes in the context of the Netherlands, quote, the Minister of Social Affairs efficiently proclaimed in November 2003 that the emancipation of autochthonous, read white, women had been accomplished. To come from governmental, trans or non-governmental contexts where gender equality as a marker of development is emphasised. I mean, really, the amount of funding from the World Bank, from the Soros Foundation, from USAID, and so on, is increasing really quite dramatically. As the Feminist and Women's Studies Association, UK and Ireland, has discovered in its documenting of narratives used to justify closures of women's and gender studies department in the UK, and just to give you a quick picture, this year, the last undergraduate gender and women's studies department closed in the UK, that there's now no longer any undergraduate degree awarding departments. So there, of course, there are lots of courses. This position, feminism as anachronistic and less exported, is consistently reiterated as a reason in institutional contexts for not needing feminist courses in higher education anymore. And the context I work in at the London School of Economics, which is a graduate institution, remains afloat because of its historical and contemporary education of international elites who do that, who can do that work most appropriately. Fine. It can hardly come as a shock to feminists that institutions hostile to academic feminism use whatever discourses are available to them to rationalise closures, marginalisation and inadequate resourcing, or to control theoretical developments. But Western feminist theory's own production of its past consistently reproduces a similar linearity, even when those shifts are lamented. Thus, past politicization and unity are nostalgically invoked or rejected, and the extraordinarily vibrant and diverse experiment in alternative knowledge production that is academic feminism today, is routinely accused of forgetting politics, women, its own legacy, and so on. Insofar as such accounts confirm the belief that politics, reality, and transformative feminist knowledge can never be found in or accessed via post-structuralist accounts or tools, or politics post-institutionalization, or politics of the institution, feminism contributes to the conditions of its own critical and political erasure. These stories are clearly framed also by a generational logic, one which positions one's own generation, rather depressingly predictably, as clearly at the cutting edge of both feminist politics and feminist theory. It is extraordinarily rare to talk about past, present, or future, except insofar as one is presumed to be that time's subject. Things were better in my past. Things are vibrant now because of what I'm doing. Things can only get better or worse to the extent that I am listened to or ignored, respectively. This logic presumes, of course, well, among, well, it presumes a lot of things, but it presumes, interestingly for me, an even pattern of institutionalization, of course, a universal one that is graspable as our legacy, everybody's legacy, whatever generation we may inhabit. This is problematic for a range of reasons, and the term generation being just the start. It prevents us, I think, providing a nuanced account, actually, of the material conditions of institutionalization of feminist thought that differ rather profoundly across and within national contexts. Providing instead an overarching common gloss to experiences of producing and passing on feminist theory. One need only look to the body of work on European feminist theory, and in particular the Athena journals, to get a picture of the unevenness of this process. In some of my own work with colleagues on this, the patterns of European institutionalization might be better understood as to do with date of institutionalization of academic feminism, rather than attachment to a particular school of thought, and indeed whether or not the pattern for that context is autonomous or integrated. And to do with the ways, as I mentioned before, this is or is not funded. And by whom? The critique of feminism as increasingly professionalized and narcissistic takes one mode, privileged places of institutionalization, which is the exception rather than the rule indeed, as the model, and uses this to critique feminist theory for not being diverse enough. Abstract theory comes to stand as evidence for feminism's demise. It's a strange tautology. Since large numbers of feminist theorists were globally working in constrained conditions in and out of the academy, with or without funding, often for free, who are we talking about when this trajectory is presumed? In this respect, and then those people, that small minority of people blamed for something that's supposed to have happened to feminist theory. In this respect, too, one can overlay the shifts narrated as uncontested, as linked to a generational logic that also reproduces national boundaries. If there is a past to be inherited, progress, loss, or return, one has to have someone in mind as its inheritor, someone with a shared past to the past of the subject. The belief that there can be is in the end, I believe, a reconsolidation of national trajectories. I pass on feminism to others in a context that recognizes and shares my parameters, that confirms my own status as a feminist subject. I can pass on and then give up, I guess. And indeed, heteronorms, I pass on feminist theory, presumably because the next generation, quote unquote, doesn't occupy the same space as me, because younger people will have their own lives to lead. Surely we can't imagine those lives as shared, as linked, for example, by desire. Is the subject of feminism always young then? Are we always passing on to a new generation? What happens to people as they age? This is an important question. Who are we talking about? I keep saying that, I've got that all the way through. Generational logic assumes young, heterosexual or heterosexualized women are the future. The rest of us are dead or dying. I'm feeling old lately, I don't know. Feminist passion. And it's interesting that Robin mentioned annoyance and passion, because those are the two affects that I'm going to talk about a little bit now. Again, my tone indicates I'm not a neutral deliverer of these remarks. You can no doubt tell that these stories and their effects produce, or the critique derives from, anger on my part. I am annoyed at the ways in which discourses of gender equality, as having been achieved, functions as an alibi for violent intervention, epistemically or in reality, in those places assumed not to have achieved it, where gender equality discursively carries global inequality, at the ways in which the same presumption operates to minimize the importance of gender and women's studies in the West, except insofar as it attends to, quote unquote, the transnational, with very implicit assumptions about where the transnational resides that are strikingly familiar. At the ways in which those come together in the figure of the international gender expert, whose mainstreaming is assumed to carry political feminist weight rather than embodying its contradictions. And I'm annoyed at the ways in which the stories of progress and loss that feminist theory tells about its own past are coextensive rather than simply co-opted, reproduce rather than challenge those global dynamics. Perhaps I just need some interdisciplinary feminist anger management. And perhaps I'll get that here this weekend. But actually, I think that anger locates me in ways that I want to be accountable for, that motivates the stories that I tell and want to tell. I remember Rosie Bydotti suggesting in Patterns of Dissonance that passion was the point of theory, that without it, feminist theory has no real value. I've always loved feminist theory for its engagement of the known, the knower, the knowable, and the problematization of all of those, and its utopianism that I refuse to let go of, in terms of a belief, whatever the evidence to the contrary, that change is always possible and that we can think and live differently. Without passion, which I completely for no real reason define as the belief that pleasure, the belief in pleasure as valuable, the belief in change as possible, theory has no value, for it can only reproduce or describe the terms of the known. How to challenge what is known, to not only describe these stories, but to tell different ones, ones that instill passion rather than inertia or hopelessness. Correcting the historical record isn't going to work, since it will still privilege one story over another, a process that reduces rather than increases political accountability in the present. And here I'm drawing on the work of many feminist historiographers, Liz Gross, Jennifer Terry, both of whom are in the room, Gayatri Spivak, Antoinette Burton, and so on. Telling a range of stories also leaves unaddressed how it is that certain stories are secured over others, despite our common sense or political awareness of complexity. So there are two avenues I'm interested in exploring in response to the stories I sketched, both of which emphasize methodology over content on the basis that opening up rather than closing down versions of history is a way of reorienting our focus onto the significant political battles of the present, thereby opening up rather than closing down future possibilities. And it's not a quote, but that could, of course, have been a quote from Robin Wiegman. First, I want to pick at the conditions of dominant stories to establish what political, epistemological, and ontological work they are achieving. To ask, how are these dominant stories secured through our publishing and teaching practices, despite the fact that we know they obscure the complexities that we cherish? And second, I imagine intervening in these stories by starting from key exclusions and offering grounded and accountable possibilities for experimentation. So the issue here is not that there aren't, you know, a proliferation of feminist stories, but that only certain stories don't need evidencing. And it's the stories that don't need evidencing or that pass as a common sense that I'm interested in. Every time I talk about the project, someone says, but I've read other stories. And, you know, you're very welcome to say that. But in a sense, I'm not so interested in the kinds of stories that need evidencing, that develop a very specific kind of textual argument and so on, because in a sense they build their argument. In other words, they have to prove it to the reader. I'm interested in arguments that pass, that effectively pass our notice. So one part of the project that I thankfully have almost finished maps the stories I've introduced by looking at what interdisciplinary feminist journals in English from, mostly from 1998 to present, but sometimes for a little earlier, by reading the journal articles in those journals for those common sense glosses. So the journals I've chosen are, you can ask me about this, Signs, Differences, Feminist Review, Feminist Theory, NORA, which is the Nordic Journal of Women's Studies, European Journal of Women's Studies, Gender and Society, Gender, Place and Culture, Australian Feminist Studies, Feminist Studies, Journal of International Women's Studies, and a handful of social theory journals, Critical Inquiry, Theory, Culture and Society, and Body and Society. And I stopped, actually, at a certain point, because none of the kind of information I was getting was any different. So it's, I mean, is that rigor? I don't know. To highlight the importance of community language, the work cites the source of the extract that I introduced rather than the author throughout. This is to emphasize the role of editors, peer reviewers, and publishing conventions in the establishment of these stories. Which aspects of an article are assumed to need referencing, which way of telling stories needs further explanation or argumentation, are not individual decisions alone. I mean, you mentioned, you know, getting a journal article back and being told which, you know, rejected or which bits to rewrite and so on. This is the process for all of us. Some parts of what we write don't get asked to be revised, some parts do. And I'm thinking of this in a sense as a kind of collective project of what passes. I work on the editorial of Feminist Review, and I'm constantly looking at articles, and I'm focusing in effect then on the things that I think are contentious and need more elaboration. I'm obviously not focusing in on the things that I think are completely self-evident. Right? So on some level, the article reflects my presumptions as much as it reflects in a slightly different way to the ways it reflects the author's. So I'm interested, if you like, in thinking about the technology of the presumed of the recent history of feminist theory, rather than the particular arguments a given author may be making that are worthy of note. And there's lots of things that are worthy of note. Of course, if you want, you can Google these citations, and then you'll just get who they are. it's an interesting thing that when I've written articles on it, that people are really unhappy about the fact that I don't cite individuals. And partly, of course, that's because of career trajectories and the ways in which, I mean, particularly in the UK, because we're now moving to a system where university departments will be funded by how prestigious its individual researchers are, which will be judged by how often they're cited. So from one hideous form of assessment to another, really. And so if you don't cite someone, then basically, you know, you may be holding them back. So in that sense, I appreciate that it's not an uncontentious position. I need to... Ha-ha. Oh, could somebody turn the top light on? Could you maybe? I can't move because I'm attached. Oh, no. I'm attached. I'm just thinking it might be that one. Oh. Well, I can read them. Oh, sorry. It's me. How do I turn it back on? So I'm just very briefly, I can't go into this very much, but I'm just briefly going to highlight a couple of the kinds of issues with the progress and loss narratives and the return narratives that I've basically told you, that I've indicated to you. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about a kind of citation strategy that I'm currently working on. So the first thing that I mentioned when I was talking about part of the problems of progress and loss narratives were the ways in which certain subjects become erased. And one of the ways in which that happens is by the placement of particular schools of thought and particular theorists in given decades. And then a kind of narrative that assumes that either those perspectives have been moved on from or explicitly displaced, right? So that you don't actually have to say that something doesn't operate in the present if the way you frame it in the past assigns it a given decade or assigns it a given place and time. And this kind of general statement that you'll notice, and you'll notice with lots of these, doesn't have any citations in it, is really, really common of the journal, the passings that I'm focusing in. So this would be typical. Since the early 80s, lesbians, feminists of colour, post-colonial critics and queer theorists, as well as post-feminist and anti-feminist women, have exposed the ethnocentric conceits and consequences of the foundational categories of Western feminist thought, women, gender and sex. Done. Handled. No worries. The issue there, then, is that this has been achieved and we're, in effect, moving to a different... to a different kind of period. And this is really, really cool. I mean, you have a look at this paragraph. I mean, it's absolutely... It's what I call, in teaching, the black feminist paragraph, you know, where people are talking about what they think has happened and they're getting it from feminist theorists. It's not a way of talking about what students do wrong. This is coming from feminist theorists that effectively doesn't quite... It's the sort of floating paragraph. It's like, how do you account for this change? And it sort of operates here as this thing that occurred, you know, apparently not before the 80s, and apparently, always textually framed by its move then into either post-colonial or post-structuralist criticism. So just to read the second one, perhaps the most important legacy of 1980s feminism is the crucial concern with difference, initiated by feminists of colour who called attention to their exclusion and or misrepresentation by mainstream feminist accounts of women. The focus on women's differences was underwritten as well by post-structuralist feminism. Both critiques have produced the most recent object of feminist theoretical inquiry, the female subject who inhabits diverse cultural locations and for whom gender is dynamically engaged with numerous other social categories and discourses. Note that by the end of the paragraph, race, sexuality and so on have disappeared. That here we just have a diverse set of cultural locations without any kind of specificity. In progress narratives, racial critique often provides the dynamic for a move to difference more generally, yet is consistently framed as catalyst, important legacy initiated by feminists of colour and so on. A combined move in this extract, initiated by black feminists, endorsed by post-structuralist feminists, shifts attention to a different subject, one who inhabits diverse cultural locations and who is the most recent object of feminist theoretical inquiry. Race and power have disappeared by the end of the extract. While black feminism and post-structuralism are on the one hand represented here as of the same era, and as having related concerns, the temporality I'm tracing is reinforced by black feminism's location as catalyst. This is the second. All the citations are from the 1980s. Two related intellectual debates provided the impetus for critical reflection on the subject of feminist thinking. First, women of colour and third world women, feminists, critiqued the subject implicit within most feminist thought at the time, a subject that normalised the experience of white middle class first world women, Hooks 1984, Trin 1989. This critique stimulated greater interest in the multiplicity of oppression and fractured the notion of woman and her experiences. Second, a growing interest in post-structural psychoanalytic perspectives, e.g. those of Lacan and Derrida, as well as Foucault's notion of power discourse, also profoundly affected feminist theory. Feminists appreciated post-structural attempts to deploy an anti-essentialist worldview, reject totalizing grand theory, and embrace multiplicity, difference, and the decentered subject, Sarup 1988. So you'd be forgiven for saying, yeah, but all of the citations are from the 1980s, so everything's locked into the 1980s. But if you look at the language employed, it's post-structuralism that is growing in interest, right? It's imaginatively and linguistically still active, embracing multiplicity, difference, and the decentered subject. So even when the citations seem to indicate that, you know, a whole range of things have been surpassed, and this is still being written in the 1990s, there's a way in which the order of it, and in this case, though this isn't always the case, the gender of who is cited, indicates a shift from feminism to post-structuralism, imagining them as somehow separate, and from a catalyst of black feminist theory into a kind of general concern with difference, emblematic of the post-structuralist position, which has already been separated out from any feminist past. Post-structuralism thus imaginatively spills over into the next decade, while the critiques of women of colour and third world women in this extract are temporarily fixed by their frames of citation, as becoming tropes in the service of a teleology they are no longer the subjects of. A similar kind of thing happens with sexual critique. Sexual critique is of increased plurality, and in the process, I want to argue, lesbian feminism disappears in what we call the sex wars. So here, Feminist Review 2000. From the feminist sex wars of the 1980s to the queer theory and politics of the 1990s, debates about the politics of sexuality have been at the forefront of contemporary theoretical, social, and political demands. Pro-sex feminists argued that radical feminism's representation of women as disempowered actors fails to see women as sexual subjects in their own right. While radical feminists see female sexuality, quote unquote, as repressed by the patriarchy, the pro-sexuality movement sees repression as produced by heterosexism and sex negativity, cultural operations often seen as institutionalized in feminism itself. Radical feminism, clearly taking place here in the 1970s, because it occurs before the sex wars, or maybe before that, is imagined in wholly negative terms. By framing sexual politics in terms of pro-sex demands, radical feminist analyses of sexuality can be reduced to a focus on repression and indeed be discounted as sexual politics at all. This historical and political separation is linguistically reinforced through a series of refusals. Thus, radical feminist representation fails to see women as sexual subjects and understands sexuality only as repressed. In addition, what are perceived to be the key theoretical terms of 70s radical feminism, female sexuality, patriarchy, and sex negativity, are placed in scare quotes, while pro-sex accounts of heterosexism remain unqualified. So they're true to some extent, then they're present and they're real. Oddly absent from the above account is any mention of lesbian feminism, perhaps resonant only in the term female sexuality, then to be erased by an immediate insistence on feminism's heterosexism. Lesbian feminism is also absent from the pro-sex demands of the 80s and 90s, represented here instead by queer theory and politics, a general, later, pro-sexuality movement, whose focus is heterosexism, but whose subjects remain unspecified. What does remain is an undoubtedly anachronistic female sexuality replaced by the sexual as well as textual play of the 90s. We know, of course, which we're supposed to identify with. We're supposed to identify with a textual play. So here again, whereas the earlier generation of feminist scholars challenged patriarchal ideologies that reduced women's prime contribution to society to their biological capacity for nurturing and reproducing a whole generation, the new gender theorists are fundamentally concerned with the historical subjectivity of sexed individuals and the embodiment of sexual identity, seen as indeterminate, ambiguous, multiple, Morris 1995. For Judith Butler, 1993, who argues that sexual identity is lived as a highly regulated performance. One is not female, one can only do female. In that case, then, what I'm drawing your attention to here, which I'll come back to, is the ways in which it's Butler and Morris who are understood as present that are cited, whereas the earlier generation of feminist scholars is implied, so that we have no quotations, because we actually don't need them, because we can all agree that this is the case. In lost narratives, I mean, that was the progress, that's progress. In lost narratives, even more oddly, identity and difference debates are rarely mentioned. Yet instead, we have a move to a time, 1990s onwards, of increased institutionalization and loss of politics. The 70s is equally uniform, and the 80s equally implicitly framed by two poles, leading not to a celebration of multiplicity, but to a depoliticized present. Instead of black and lesbian feminists here, it is the euphemistic reference in this first quote to the passing of time that moves from active politicization into a depoliticized, institutionalized focus on difference. Then and there, back in the 1970s, we saw ourselves, as many other feminists did, as producers of feminist theory, which then informed and was changed by our practice as feminists. We entered the academy to know and therefore to change the world. Over the period that has led to the noun here, it has been interesting to observe the gradual assimilation of academic feminism and the entry into it of successive cohorts who came to feminism through the text rather than through political practice. One of the results, because there's been no politics or political practice since the 1970s, one of the results of the passing of time and the necessary correlates of assimilation has been the rise of a distinct category of feminist theory and a distinctive professional category of feminist theorists. Remember, as I started, where exactly? What has supported this is a gradually decreasing awareness of the earlier feminist critique of theory as ideas produced through material practices cross-cut by the operations of power. Similar binaries, practice, theory, activist, professional, world, text, and so on, ground the story. But this time, the first term is imbued with integrity and the latter with opportunism. Through this series of oppositions, it is feminist professionals who bear primary responsibility for the demise of feminist activism. But first of all, we have to establish feminist activism as over. So we have to do two things. We have to establish it as over, and we have to make it academic feminist professionals' fault. This retrospectively, interestingly, codes the essentialism... But how these figures relate to the identity politics of the 80s remains obscure. This retrospectively codes the essentialism of the 70s, first and foremost, as one of... racial exclusion, but here, that the earlier parts did, but here it has to be passed over in order to establish that something has been wholly lost, because you can't establish that something's been wholly lost if it was invoked or catalyzed by black feminists in particular, because to do that would be to effectively make those subjects responsible, and that isn't going to happen. The second example, loss is regrettable sophistication, even when it's like, well, you know, I know that it's better, we know it's better and so on, but, you know, still there were things that were lost, even if they're fantasized, still follow the same kind of trajectory. I'm not going to read that long quote, but the signs one at the bottom there, perhaps I'm just mourning what I sense is the end of feminist activism, at least among that large group of feminists who now reside behind the walls of the university. And I think what's interesting there is a splitting of the subject speaking and the end of feminist activism among someone else. So there's a certain kind of transfer of loss, a certain transfer of nostalgia, that of course in that moment I'm just mourning what I sense is the end of feminist activism is clearly a kind of very personally expressed loss, but it's immediately transferred onto somebody else's, you know, loss of activism, other people's depoliticization, young people, people institutionalized in the university, as if somehow the feminist theorist writing don't already also occupy that position. Material returns. So loss and progress. I'm most interested in two things. One is the use of affect, so the ways in which affect is, or an interest in affect, is used as a way of returning to embodiment or returning to that which exceeds language. But I'm not going to talk about that one here. I'm going to talk about the invocation of the material as forward to the good old days in feminist theoretical narratives. I think partly also in the context of this space, because materialism maps so easily, or the invocation of it maps so easily onto theory, practice, debates, and who we assume is a practitioner, who's political, and who's a theorist. The first account is very typical. So here, as Rosenau points out, materialist approaches are an anathema to many forms of postmodernism. Postmodernists of various persuasion, both the nihilist skeptics and the more moderate affirmatives, reject those versions of modern social science that claim a materialist reality. This leads them to embrace idealist and relativist approaches to knowledge. This relativism cripples their ability to adjudicate between different knowledge claims. That first account is typical. It's a lack of citation again, an appeal to our common sense desire for theory to be political again, and an unquestioned sense that it hasn't been through post-structuralism, and that this is to do with the turning away of the gaze from particular things, economy, oppression, the real lives of women, and so on. So another couple of quotes. The focus on representation has led to a relative neglect of socioeconomic concerns. For people not focusing on socioeconomic concerns, I guess. The recognition of the complexity of global issues, sadly not reflected in this issue, means there is much work for feminists still to do, implicitly. I've added that still. And then EJWS, one of the problems with the whole anti-essentialist movement, the whole anti-essentialist movement, is that it tends to eradicate commonalities among women. I just recently spent a month in India. Did you? That's lovely. And I do feel that despite cultural and geographic and economic differences, I have more in common with a lot of the women in India than I do with a lot of the men in my own country. And this, I mean, I'm being very flippant in that moment, but that is, it's so repeated. That's why it's, you know, that effectively Western feminist theory has lost touch with its material roots. But don't worry, because there's loads of people globally, and guess where they live? Who need our help still, thank God, because that means we can end up still focusing on the social and the material. Because, and of course, what's implicit in that is that there's that we have achieved it. That on some level, therefore, that the material still resides elsewhere. It resides elsewhere geographically, and occasionally it resides elsewhere in terms of class, right? But it's never interrogated in terms of the materialism of the institution or the materialism of everyday practice for anybody. And it's always, and the interesting thing here is that materialism slips then into oppression, actually. What is often meant by materialism is, in fact, the dreadful conditions of women's lives. And implicitly here, then, what we're also being asked to do is effectively critique our previously flippant interest in pleasure. Right? And who most had a flippant interest in pleasure? Queer theorists, right? And implicitly, what's very interesting in a lot of this material is that, you know, you hear the word butler screaming at you through these, although she's often not deliberately cited. So she's often there in terms, well, she often is cited, but if she isn't, it's very much in terms of, you know, this rather flippant, silly focus on the performative. And I think that one of the ways in which that's secured in narrative terms is that that materialism comes to always means bad conditions of existence, never possibilities of existence, never a range of possibilities of existence. And I think that that's a real impoverishment of the nature of the notion of materiality. One of the other things that then happens, okay, we hope for a step beyond, a shift in focus towards the material, but one nevertheless informed by insights and perspectives and so on, right? We've learnt from our past, we're moving to the future. Where once feminist sociology was deeply engaged with issues that women confront on the job and in the economy, there is a retreat into the realm of discourse. So no interrogation at all about the ways in which these terms are being used. And then finally, language matters, discourse matters, culture matters. There is an important sense in which the only thing that does not seem to matter anymore is matter. Now, what's interesting to me about this is that endlessly invoked is how feminism has forgotten materiality, or materialism, or oppression, or the economy, or global conditions of women's existence, and so on and so forth. But of course, we're not essentialist anymore, right? So this is the pattern. But what's interesting to me is that this is always invoked rhetorically as some new concern that someone's going to bring in. Actually, it's one of the most consistently cited needs in the journals I looked at from 1995 or 6 right through to present. Everybody consistently says for the last 10 years, where once we were involved in this, now we're concerned with language. It's, you know, and unless you read this body of literature, it's constant, you know, and so this, that language matters, discourse matters, the only thing that doesn't matter, rubbish. It's constantly invoked as the thing that matters. Interestingly, it's very rarely followed through. And I think that's because its function is to reproduce the progress and loss narratives that we already have, and to effectively insist that politics has abandoned in order to find it again elsewhere or find it again now. And if you find it again now, then you can be the feminist subject who finds it. Post-structuralism, of course, has no subject in these accounts, but is presumably, as I say, focused on pleasure over oppression, differences between women rather than commonalities, style and discourse over the economy. And I think that what's interesting to me about that is that this is one way in which I think those missing lesbians and black feminists of the passing of time re-emerge, if you like, as that which is displaced through questions of pleasure, style, and difference. So that, in a sense, you can read then back into that narrative the subjects who have already been disappeared.
From Tina.
Thank you. That argument of the ways in which that the particular subjects reappear through a kind of implicit displacing of particular concerns through a focus on materialism means that that's the work that the invocation of materialism needs to do. That's why it doesn't get worked through. This plea for a return is also framed as if it were new. I've already said that. The lament, in other words, is what secures the teleology. It can't be resolved because it would, of course, have to have a history which has to be absent and a subject who has to be displaced. Post-structuralism becomes evacuated of any political purchase and the institutionalised comes to bear the burden of those fantasised failings. In the process, we disappear class, race and sexuality only to rediscover them anew as embodiment or materiality. Again, I want, rather defensively, perhaps to emphasise it's not that discussions of materiality are not theoretically important, but that the rhetorical invocation of its importance relies on a history that is implied and does not need to be evidenced. That history rewrites post-structuralism as discontinuous from its political roots and assumes a politicised theoretical subject, no politicised theoretical subject before or after that date. And here the role of biography, I think, is interesting in terms of what one does or doesn't recognise as political. You'd think that... Well, no, I'm not going to go into that. So to my second intervention, which I'm going to do very fast indeed, is to pursue telling stories differently rather than telling different stories. How might we reform the relationship between feminism's constituent parts to allow what are currently phantom presences to take shape? Can we start from what is absent and experiment with ways of returning the erased rather than nostalgic fantasies of unity to the present? My research takes as its cue two central processes through which the dominant narratives I critique are secured: citation and the subject-object relations in feminism, the generational drive. I'm only going to talk about citation here. I'll talk about the subject-object relation in the seminars a bit. These tactics are not understood as prescriptive must-dos for other theorists, but as interventions for opening up possible histories and futures that we do not already fully know in advance, but which are located in political exclusions of the present writing of the past. And in that sense, then, they're not random focusing on exclusions. They're focusing on the exclusions that are perpetuated by the telling of particular stories. As I've already indicated, citation practice is really key for the way in which these stories are maintained and managed, for persuading the reader not only that the particular argument, but also the history it produces are right. One of the things that occurs then is that post-structuralism is always through citation, positioned as the first to do something. And the way which this occurs is to split post-structuralism from its feminist any of its feminist histories. So that Butler is always framed as marking a break rather than a continuity. That she's framed particularly, and then interestingly, as having a sibling relationship with male post-structuralists and never female antecedents. And one of the reasons for that, I think, is in order to is to split feminism from post-structuralism so that post-structuralism can be a focus on difference in general. So this is very typical, this kind of statement. Judith Butler transformed the study of gender by using Foucault to apply post-structuralist conceptions of the subject to it. Or because of the influence of Foucault and Derrida, recondite abstractions characterise postmodern theory in general and Butler's books in particular. And one of the things that I've been experimenting with then is taking what's displaced by such a kind of framing that is absolutely unevidenced. By looking at what happens if you take, in this case, lesbian feminist antecedents to Butler and reinsert them very forcefully and violently back into their representations, as it were. This is just an experiment. So the first one would look like Judith Butler transformed the study of gender by using Wittig to apply lesbian concepts of the subject to it. Or, because of the influence of Wittig and Irigaray, recondite abstractions characterise postmodern theory in general, and Butler's books in particular. And what I'm trying to do here is indicate that when you challenge the presumed citation tracks of particular theorists, you actually challenge the historical narrative. And you also challenge the assumed split between, for example, things like Marxist feminist critique and post-structuralism. That in effect you think, by a very simple technique, an alternative way of imagining the history through what has been erased. And I have one last... Oops. Sentence. So my interest in folding erased histories into critical representations of feminist history in the present is not to propose a singular alternative history we would hold in common, right? So, I mean, you could include a whole range of people in these citations. It's not about Wittig or Butler or Foucault, there's an interesting triad, but about developing a tactics of memory that might allow us to challenge some of the political erasures that these stories effect. The intention is modest in that respect, wanting to surface what is potently absent through recombination. This works as a kind of serious joke, ideally productive of a laugh of recognition in the reader, so I'm glad you sort of laughed. Its function is disruptive rather than instantiative, and is intended to open up rather than close down other possibilities in the present. What other histories are there? What are their political priorities? I believe that keeping meaning open in this way is a primary feminist responsibility. Thank you.